So internal standards, how does this actually work? Let's start out by looking at a regular external standard calibration chromatogram. We have benzene at 50. We have two peaks. The size of the peaks is proportional to the 50. We have 100. The size of the peaks is now proportional to the 100. And notice they're twice as big. So, how does the internal standard work? Well, with an internal standard, here we have a chromatogram with an internal standard at 50 parts per million. Notice we have an extra peak. This same chromatogram at 100 parts per million, notice we have the same peak, but now our quantitation peaks are bigger. The internal standard, however, stays the same. The foundation of internal standard quantitation is that instead of being related to the quantitation ion, it's related to the ratio between the quantitation ion and the internal standard. So that now, instead of looking at the size of this, we're looking at the ratio between this one and this one. And that's the difference. So that if something happened, like let's say, for example, there's a bad injection and instead of picking up a microliter, it picks up a half a microliter, then these peaks would both be half as big, but the quantitation would still be good. So that's the key to it, is that the quantitation is in the ratio between the two, not in the absolute amount. Here's an unknown sample. So now our quantitation is, instead of the absolute amount of this one, it's related to the ratio between these two. So you can see that if this one is 50, with this a little bit bigger, this one is going to be maybe about 40 because this one's smaller, in spite of the fact that the internal standard is bigger. The computer software is set up and expects to do this. Obviously, you have to tell the computer where the internal standard is, and you have to identify, and you give it a name, and you give it a quantitation. Typically, you call it a 50 or something. It doesn't really matter because it falls out of the calculations. So one of the tricks to internal standards is how the samples are originally set up. Let's say you have a run. Typical run might be a blank, two standards, a control, and then maybe sample one, sample two. Get some autosampler vials, label the vials appropriately, put in 500 microliters exactly of each of the blank, the standards, the control, etc. Put in exactly 500 microliters into the respective vials. Take your internal standard, put in exactly 10 microliters. And I say 10 microliters because the internal standard will typically come in 2,000 parts per million. You put 10 microliters into 500 microliters, and you're going to end up with like 50 or something like that, which is about what you want. You want your peak to be about the same size. It's important that it's done exactly the same every time because it's the ratio that you're looking at. Whereas in standard analytical chemistry, everything has to be the same. Using an internal standard, you have a lot more flexibility, but the ratio going in has to be the same. This comes up because I would say often in analysis, you just can't make everything the same. You just can't do it. An example would be an extraction procedure. Very often in analysis, You start out by doing liquid extraction, like with a separatory funnel, or a solid phase extraction with a column, something like that. Add the internal standard appropriately. Go through the procedure. whatever happens to the analytes will happen to the internal standard equally, and the ratio, which is what you're looking for, should be a reflection of the quantitation regardless of what's happened. Let's say your efficiency isn't very good. You only get a 50% extraction. Let's say one of your columns is bad or something like that. It shouldn't make any difference. You need to run, you know, you run your controls and stuff to check to make sure your quality is the way you think it is. I think of internal standards as related to mass spectrometry, GC mass spec. Common in GC mass spec is that the sample is derivatized. It's like you derivatize it and turn it into something else. If you're running an internal standard, the internal standard goes through the same procedure. This is like another step. And are there problems in the derivatization? Well, if you pick your internal standard carefully, variations in the sample should appear in the variations in the analytes, and your ratio should come out okay. You need to pick an internal standard that matches your analyte as closely as possible. Both for its behavior and its physical characteristics, its chromatographic behavior. The ideal is to use a stable isotope. And sometimes you can do that. Like if you're doing fatty acids or some kinds of carbohydrates, just use an isotope of the same thing you're using. Isotopes, of course, having a different mass, but the same chemical characteristics. And the isotope ought to chromatograph the same, but the mass spectrometer is an amazing tool and will separate them. In general, the GC mass spec is absolutely the most incredible piece of instrumentation there is. But the GC mass spec is not very stable. And like slight variations in the vacuum will lower the sensitivity. Well, you lower the sensitivity with an external standard and your quantitations go all bad. But if you're using an internal standard, everything will be affected equally and your quantitation should come out okay. One of the tricks to using internal standards properly is a good, consistent treatment of your standard. You need to add it exactly the same every time, and your internal standard needs to be exactly the same every time. I've never seen a GC mass spec analysis that does not use an internal standard. The GC mass spec, that thing costs $100,000. Instrument time is expensive. Calibrations are expensive time on the instrument, and as an analyst, the calibration's a nuisance. You gotta hassle with it and stuff. It's like if you take good care of your internal standard and you set them up properly every time, you set up your controls properly every time, use the same internal standard day to day, week to week, month to month, then you shouldn't have to calibrate very often.